Welcome, everybody. I'm Matt Kane. I'm with the Agora Institute. Thank you so much for being here. I want to thank our hosts, Springton Lake Presbyterian Church, Rick Marshall and his staff. We give them a round of applause for hosting us. Thank you so much for being here. We have recycling bins in the back. The blue ones are for iPhones, the red ones for Android. So as you leave, just know that proceeds will be going to the food bank. After you hear this talk, you may want to just put it in there. But we are so pleased that you've chose to be with us tonight. I'm going to introduce my good friend Andy Crouch, who's going to MC for us. Andy is the new senior strategist for communications at the Templeton Foundation. And we are so eager to get into the content tonight. We're going to walk through some deeper water as it relates to technology and how it's impacted our lives. The fact that you've taken time out on a Wednesday night to be with us, we are really grateful. So without further ado, could you join me in welcoming to the stage Andy Crouch?
Well, good evening. Thank you, Matt, and the team behind the Agora Institute for hosting this. I think the size of this crowd and the buzz in the room reflects three things, it seems to me. One is the amazing track record of this institute in hosting conversations that are worthwhile and matter and get us all thinking and get us talking. And it's just a great gift what happens in these events. The second thing I think the energy that we bring to this tonight reflects is the significance of the topic. Naomi and I were talking before we started here about just how much interest and desperation there is on this topic of especially technology and children and families. And I think the third thing that this energy represents is the qualities of our speaker tonight, Naomi Schaefer Riley. I've had the pleasure of knowing her a little bit for a number of years. I've been edited her by her several times. And I think Naomi brings three things to this conversation that are very important. First of all, she brings the background and skills and kind of temperament and training of a journalist. That has been her principal work for a number of years. Worked at the Wall Street Journal, then edited a magazine, a founding editor of a magazine called In Character, which was a really beautiful, significant publication for quite a while. And in more recent years, I think the biggest impact her journalistic work has made has been through books. Books like God on the Quad, which probed religion, religious colleges, and education. Till Faith Do Us Part, about interfaith marriage in the United States. But to show you the breadth of Naomi's interests, her most recent book is The New Trail of Tears, which is an exploration and really kind of investigation of the ways that American polity and society have, in many ways, in her view, failed Native Americans. And that kind of leads to, I think, the second thing Naomi brings, which is she's not just a journalist, she is also a columnist, published in the New York Post and elsewhere. And a columnist's job is both to have the sort of truth-telling rigor of the journalist, and then to do it in a way that's pugnacious, provocative, and challenging. And Naomi definitely does that. I thought about reading some of her New York Post, the names of her columns, they always have a point of view. It's never the point of view you might expect. And they always raise your hackles a little bit and get you reading. And sometimes they raise some people's hackles more than others. And that's actually a good thing. So I think you're going to bring both of those to us tonight, that journalistic kind of investigation, but also that columnist kind of pugnacious provocation. And she comes to this topic as a mother with her husband, Jason, of three children, 10, 8, and 4 of years of age, which means she is in the midst of doing maybe the most bold thing you can do, which is write a book about parenting while you still have young children. The wise thing to do is either write it before you have young children or long after, but she is actually doing it right in the midst, and that's going to make this a very timely talk for her and for us tonight. So please help me welcome Naomi Schaefer Riley.
Thank you so much for coming out tonight. I want to thank the Agora Institute and everyone involved. I want to thank the folks from Templeton who are here tonight, and Andy, who I have long admired as a writer and editor himself. As Andy mentioned, I do have three kids, and so I'm talking about this topic even before I have teenagers, which may just be an exercise in what we call chutzpah. But you'll have to excuse me, and I do have the journalist backing me up to hopefully offer you some research beyond my own personal experience tonight. So with that, let me start. I made it 2.5 years into motherhood before my first trip to the emergency room. My daughter Emily had a cough that wouldn't let up, and it was now accompanied by wheezing. The squeaking noise under her breath was easy for me, a lifelong asthmatic, to recognize. So there we were, curtained off in an area of the children's section of urgent care. And that's when I looked up and saw something mounted in the corner of the room, a television with Dora the Explorer bounding across the screen. It was there in the middle of the night in a strange place, but here was a familiar face. She was immediately entranced, and I was immediately relieved. Sitting on the edge of her bed, memories of long evenings with my own father in the emergency room came back to me. During each 12-minute breathing treatment, I would count the animals on the wallpaper. How many giraffes? How many zebras? Why are all the rooms the same? Even when I was old enough to read, I couldn't focus on a book during these ordeals. While we waited for what seemed like hours between each time a doctor listened to my chest, my father would do anything to entertain me. There would be bad jokes, stories from his childhood, stories from his mother's childhood, lessons about the American Revolution. As he blurred the line between stand-up comedian and college professor, it never occurred to me what must be going on in his own head. Only later, when he would recount the story of my first asthma attack before the age of 2, my face turning blue as he and my mother rushed me to the hospital, did I begin to understand how he was forced to mask his own fears and how much easier it would have been with a television on the wall tuned to a 24-hour children's television network. In an instant, Dora relieved me of my job of making funny faces, of assuring Emily that everything would be fine, of lying to her that no one would need to stick her with a needle. The presence of that television allowed me to give the doctor my full attention, to speak with him without masking my concerns or changing the words to be more child-friendly. Our night in the emergency room was long, but it could have been so much longer. There are so many occasions to be deeply grateful that we live in the 21st century, but the ability to distract us from pain, from discomfort and boredom is surely one of the greatest features of our technological age. For children with minor asthma attacks or with medical problems that are much more serious, we have learned to make time fly. But Dora and the rest of her friends on Nick Jr., PBS Kids, and the Disney Channel are not being broadcast 24 hours a day exclusively for the use of children's hospitals. There are all sorts of occasions when it is a relief for children to be occupied, let me tell you. In her book, The Plug-in Drug, Television, Computers, and Family Life, Marie Wynne articulates the ways in which television has transformed the experience of children's sickness for parents and children alike. Published in 1977, the year I was born, Wynne's description of parenting seems even more apt today than it did back then, particularly the way that parents interact with sick kids. Quote, gone are the onerous requirements of time and patience on the parents' part, the endless story readings, the tedious card games, the listening to whiny complaints, the steady need to restrain impatience, to maintain sympathy, and to act more lovingly than ever. But when adults, interestingly, are asked about their experiences with illness as children, they recall these times fondly. One woman told Wynne what a treat it was that her mother took off work when she was ill. Quote, I remember the endless card games and cutting out pictures from magazines with her. I remember lying in bed and calling to her to come and bring me this or that again and again and again. And I remember how wonderful it felt that she always came. This account made me feel so guilty for all the times that I have allowed my sick children to plant themselves on the couch and watch PBS Kids from morning until night. But I don't think that occasionally using technology to distract our children makes us bad parents. It makes us human. But still, that does not excuse us from understanding the temptations that technology presents to us as mothers and fathers, the effects it has on our children, and the trade-offs that we are making when we give our children access to technology and technology access to our children. There are so many forces pushing us to give our kids technology, from the companies themselves to our schools, our friends, and the culture at large. It is all happening so fast. One day we are wondering about whether an hour of Sesame Street is a good habit for a two-year-old, and the next minute it seems we have adolescents who won't look up from their phones long enough to have a conversation with us. The screen situation is getting away from us. Now is not the time for guilt about what we've done. It is time to take a deep breath and look at where we are, at where our children are, and where we want our families to be. Because here's the thing, there are only so many hours in a day. For that matter, there are only so many years in childhood. And when those hours and days are made to fly by, even in an effort to reduce discomfort and boredom, something can get lost in the process. I don't want to sound like one of those ladies at the supermarket telling the mother with the screaming toddler that she should enjoy these years. God knows I've been tempted to hand over my children to her and head for the parking lot. But parenthood is all about keeping things in perspective, and many of us are losing it. A 2015 survey commissioned by Common Sense Media found that tweens ages 8 to 12 are spending 5 hours and 12 minutes per day consuming digital media. That's not including listening to music and not including any time spent on screens at school or for homework. Teens or parents whose parents had college degrees consumed only slightly less than that. So what does that mean? My friend Laura Vanderkam, who writes books about the way we manage our time, is fond of saying, quote, "Time is a choice. I don't have time means it's not a priority." When we think of all the things that our kids don't seem to have a spare minute for, time to play outside, time to see their friends, to read a book for pleasure, or talk to their mom about their day, it is worth remembering that they are spending several hours a day watching videos, browsing websites, texting friends, and checking in on social media. There are no good longitudinal studies yet on the effects of smartphones because they've only been around for 10 years. Hard to believe, I know. But we do have good studies on other screens. Television has been shown to have an independent contribution to various negative outcomes for children, including language delay, poor physical health, possible delinquency, and later criminal behavior. I don't want to alarm you. Research also suggests that it's not just time spent staring at a television that influences outcomes for kids, it's also television as background noise. Heather Krikorian, who runs the Cognitive Development Media Research Lab at the University of Wisconsin, has written a number of papers on the effects on children of television that is simply on in the home for several hours a day. She says that, quote, even if a mother is just watching the news while the baby is playing, quote, we generally find negative effects. The kids are distracted from play, and the parents are distracted from social interactions with their kids. Krikorian and her colleagues found that, quote, more hours of background television negatively predicts cognitive abilities for children at 4 years of age. So what about the content? Large-scale longitudinal studies suggest that children who watch more violent television are more likely to engage in aggressive behavior as adults. A 15-year study of 500 individuals followed children from first or third grade into their mid-20s. Controlling for variables like parental aggression and social class, it found that exposure to television violence in childhood predicted increased self-reported aggressive behavior in adulthood for both boys and girls. So none of this means, of course, that all or even most kids who watch violent TV will behave violently. Indeed, as some experts have pointed out, as our video games and television has become more violent, our society seems to have become less so. But those are overall trends. These studies suggest that excessive exposure to television makes violent behavior in individuals somewhat more likely. Conversely, educational television can have a mildly positive effect on children's development. Some longitudinal studies suggest that programs like Sesame Street or Blue's Clues or Mr. Rogers can aid children's development of vocabulary and social skills. Generally speaking, these effects were observed mostly among kids in disadvantaged homes. But interestingly, for these effects to be felt in any significant way, kids need to be watching these programs with adults who are interacting with them. Researchers at Texas Tech and the University of Oregon looked at preschoolers who watched episodes of Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood and found that watching the show was associated with higher levels of empathy, but only for preschoolers whose parents interacted with them in productive ways during the show. Parents are supposed to try to help your child integrate what they learn into their own life. Ask your child questions about what they're watching. Report dialogue your child heard. Point out the good things that characters do. Tell your child to agree with the message. Encourage your child to imitate the behavior of characters, and so on. Now, come on. That is quite a big caveat. Most parents do not turn on the television this way. We are turning on Daniel Tiger as a distraction so that we can get something done without children interrupting us. So how about video games? Aren't those supposed to be at least interactive? As Tim Smith, who heads the tablet project, I'm sorry, I'm just losing stuff here. At King's College notes, the data on whether there's a real cognitive benefit to being a gamer is mixed. He explains, those kids spending time playing games are trading off other activities. Indeed, in one study he cites, parents of kids who were planning to buy their children video game consoles were divided into two groups. Half of them were asked to hold off for 6 months on the purchase. Explains Smith, the students who got the console decreased in academic performance and had more behavioral problems than those who didn't. It might be that the games altered the children's brain in some fundamental ways, but the more obvious explanation is simply that the games were a distraction and the kids wanted to play them so badly that they were acting up in order to use them more. So given what we know about the effects of television and video games on kids, there's plenty of reason to be skeptical, even at this early stage, about the effects of touchscreen games on phones and tablets. And some parallels are already clear. For instance, just like background noise seems to be distracting caregivers from speaking and interacting with children, so the use of mobile devices seems to be doing the same. Anyone who has watched parents at the playground recently will not find this surprising. Jenny Rudesky, who is based at the C.S. Mott Children's Hospital in Michigan, spent time studying the interaction of parents and children at fast food restaurants. I know, wouldn't you like that job? A lot of chicken nuggets. Not only were parents more distracted and less likely to interact with their children, but they were also more likely to be short-tempered. She and her team looked at mothers who were feeding their babies in high chairs, something that many adults find boring. When they were checking their phones at the same time, they were less likely, of course, to be speaking to the babies. And what about the kids themselves? For small kids, she actually told me that interactive features can help or hinder learning. Looking at children between the ages of 2 and 5, Heather Kerkorian says she found many kids learn more from watching someone else play a game on the screen than if the kids do it themselves. She speculates that often the games we give to kids to get them to learn things actually make it harder for them to learn, because first a child has to figure out the technology of how the game works, and then he or she has to figure out the content. Which leads us to another big area of research regarding technology, the classroom. I talked to a guy named Larry Cuban, who is an education professor at Stanford University. He's been looking for decades at the question of classroom technology. And he tells me, quote, I can say pretty categorically that there is no evidence that the use of devices and software will improve the academic achievement of students. In his book, he writes, it's called Inside the Black Box of Classroom Practice, Cuban attributes the hype for technology and its poor results to two factors. First, he said there's the novelty effect to explain student engagement with high tech. New devices, clickers in algebra class or iPads for kindergartners, motivate students initially, but then the effects wear off. Second, he says, major studies have repeatedly shown weak or no linkage between these devices or software and substantial changes in teaching practices or improved test scores. When I asked Kerkorian whether parents need to give these devices to kids at a young age so they won't be left behind, she tells me, I don't think there is cause for concern about being prepared. In fact, of the dozens of researchers, teachers, and even tech industry executives I interviewed, they all echoed this finding. There's a reason that Steve Jobs said he wouldn't give his child an iPad. But the pressures to give our kids time with technology are not simply coming from tech companies or from school. They are internal. Our family structure has changed, and so has our style of parenting. As we have fewer children, there are fewer children in our homes to entertain each other. A couple of years ago, my son had a friend over, and after a few minutes of playing together, the friend came to me and said he was bored. "Do you have a device?" he asked, to which I replied, "You are the device." That's probably a little mean for a 7-year-old, but I don't think he got my meaning. Though our kids may bicker, it is generally more fun and interesting when there are more kids around, which is also why it's so problematic that there are so few kids playing outside in our neighborhoods. No one wants to send their kid to play outside alone. But it is also our own helicopter parenting that has created this problem. Not only do we think it's unsafe for our kids to be outside alone, but we also can't bear for them to be bored or uncomfortable. We want them to be stimulated in some ways at all times. And not surprisingly, that's what they get used to. The pressures to give our kids screens are also coming from other families. I'm not looking at anyone in particular here. It is hard to be in a community where everyone has a phone or an iPad and your kid does not. It is inconvenient for other parents in carpools or kids' friends who want to make social plans for the weekend. In a few short years, our worlds have completely shifted. The assumption is now that everyone over the age of 11 has a mobile device, and that number is getting younger and younger. A recent study in the journal Pediatrics found that among adolescents aged 12 to 17, depression rates have increased 11.3% in 2014 from 8.7% in 2005. The study showed that girls are more at risk for depression, with rates rising to 17.3% in 2014 from 13.1% in 2004. The researchers note that it is no coincidence that this is the same time we have seen a rise in the use of social media. Parents of girls as young as 10 tell me that their phones are lighting up at 1 a.m. with new text messages. Girls in middle school are devastated when friends don't tag them in pictures on social media. Girls are getting demands from boys for nude pictures. Boys and girls are bombarded with unrealistic pictures and pornographic videos, which are altering the relationships between the sexes. Unfortunately, as I found, many experts have just decided to throw their hands up. Some, like Rosalind Wiseman, author of Queen Bees and Wannabes, will tell you that technology is really just too hard to control. In fact, much to my shock, when I was talking to her, she explained to me that it's useful to take away the phones at least before a sleepover party because, and I quote, "inevitably someone will send a nude picture." Inevitably? Others will tell you that technology has the potential to help your kids academically. Some will tell you it's just a matter of using the right apps or installing the right filters. Still others warn that if kids don't have enough access now, they'll just go crazy when they're older. Each of these notions, I think, has a grain of truth to it, but not much more. Technology has some educational potential, but kids who don't have it are not behind those who don't, who do. Filters can help in monitoring our children's activity, but they fail frequently because, as they say, information wants to be free. And just as with any kind of prohibited activity, there are kids who won't know how to control themselves when they get access. But we don't hand over the car keys without lessons or offer them alcohol without restriction when they are teenagers, so we can't just hand over the devices without consistently monitoring them. As I like to say, the price of internet access is eternal vigilance. Peter Wybrow, a neuroscientist and psychiatrist who runs the Semmel Institute for Neuroscience at UCLA, says that screens are, quote, like digital heroin for kids. But I asked him about this. Is this literally true, that people have become addicted? And he says we are too hung up on the medical definition of addiction. Instead, he says we have to step back and look at the way that these devices tie into the section of the brain that is, quote, ancient and reward-driven. Wybrow says that the brain is based on very simple principles. If something works for you, you want to do it again. If you get negative feedback, then you pause. Wybrow argues that a child would not even bother to learn how to walk if they just had a button that would bring them everything. If you give these gadgets to kids when they're tiny, their attention span will shorten. By the time you put them in school, they will find it extraordinarily boring. They haven't been taught to concentrate. So how many kids are affected by something that medical professionals might recognize as technology addiction? Megan Marino, who was one of the people involved in the recent guidelines released about how much technology kids should be using, told me that around 1% of kids have a true addiction. I thought that number was surprisingly large. It means that at any reasonably large high school or middle school, there'll be a few kids who literally can't lead a normal life because of their need for screen time. Marino says there are another 5 to 7% whose use of technology is problematic. Now, by contrast, the National Institute for Health report says that 2.7% of young people ages 12 to 20 have an alcohol use disorder. As parents, we certainly spend a lot more energy worrying about whether our older children are using alcohol in harmful ways than technology. At least with alcohol, we have the support of the law and most other parents when it comes to policing our children. The same is obviously not true, of technology. So here's the bad news. The only thing that can really affect kids' relationship to technology is seriously curtailing it. Eliminating screen time during the week, limiting it to a couple of hours on weekends, picking days to be technology-free, putting off the purchase of a phone for a child, ending unsupervised use of technology, postponing or banning the use of social media, monitoring kids' communication on all platforms. These are, unfortunately, the only ways that we know and that researchers know to keep kids out of harm's way. Many kids will be fine without these restrictions, and some kids will fall into trouble even with them. But as parents, I think it's time for us to stop playing the odds. These are hard changes to make, and we know they are hard because we have trouble even keeping to these rules for ourselves. We cannot stop checking our phones. We can't stop looking to see who has liked our vacation pictures or our photos from last night's dinner. We are on our phones from morning till night, and we know it is making us more anxious and less attentive to the things that are really important. But all of this, I think, is much worse for children because they have not developed the tastes and habits and temperaments that allow them to realize when things are off the rails. They haven't yet learned the pleasure of reading a book uninterrupted or getting lost in their own thoughts. They haven't recognized how much better their work is when they are only focusing on one thing at a time. They haven't yet developed the feelings of accomplishment when they do something hard, even when their friends are doing something easy. And they don't learn these things while they're young. If they don't learn these things while they're young, it's hard to imagine when they will have the chance. Again and again in my interviews, experts tell me there is no harm, not a single study that finds kids who are not given screens experience problems as a result. Kids without screens don't exhibit more behavioral problems. They are not falling behind academically. They are not having trouble getting into college or finding employment. They are not losing focus on school or even becoming social outcasts. Perhaps all of this seems obvious. But I think it bears noting because in our attempts to weigh the costs and benefits of technology, we never get around to suggesting that there are no discernible costs to withholding technology, and the upsides to having our kids spend time on other pursuits are clearly abundant. So why, I wondered, don't the specialists on children and technology, the doctors and researchers and psychologists and parenting experts, why don't they want to talk about the other side of the equation? The short answer seems to be that they don't want parents to feel guilty. Pediatricians and parenting experts I spoke with don't want to add to the burdens of parents who are already stressed out and feeling like inferior mothers and fathers. But by holding back, by never simply saying that, when it comes to screen time, less is more, they are not giving parents the best information. They are taking away our agency to make the best decisions for our children. They are only adding to the chorus of voices in business and education in our community who want us to throw up our hands and hand over the devices. So what steps can we take to rethink our use of technology? First, I think we can try applying something I call the memory test. Sometimes we are so caught up in the way we do things that we don't remember there was once another way. The old ways are not always better. But they can help us take off the blinders that are imposed by our hectic lives. Think back to your own childhood, at least if you're over the age of 25. If you had an hour of free time, what did you do? Was it always spent in front of a screen, or did your parents tell you to go out and find some other form of entertainment? Did they tell you to go outside? If you were bored in the supermarket line, what did you do? Did you have a book? Did you talk to your parents or siblings? Did you help with the groceries? Or maybe you just stared off into space. And guess what? Researchers have found that there are benefits to that as well. Sometimes the answer we find in performing the memory test may be inconvenient for our lives. When I look at children who have been dragged to their siblings' four-hour swim meet and have been given an iPad for the duration, I think back. I'm pretty sure that my parents let my sister stay at home during my mind-numbingly boring swim competitions. One of them would have missed the swim meet to be with her, but life would have continued. When you're looking over at the kids who are playing on the iPad while their parents are consuming a multi-course meal at an upscale restaurant, you can bet that 30 years ago, those kids would have been left at home. Yes, it's true a babysitter may be harder to find, but pretending you're having a nice dinner with your children while they're actually otherwise occupied is a waste of time for everyone. Technology has even shifted our approach to napping for kids. Parents used to force nap times for many more years than they do now. Even if the four-year-olds weren't sleeping, they were told to play quietly in their rooms for an hour or so. Kids are capable of this if we get them used to it. It's not just about ways to keep kids occupied either. What about communication? How on earth did we ever get picked up from activities without a cell phone? Some kids used payphones, but most of our parents were not on call 24/7. We would set a time, and we all had watches, and a place to meet, and our kids would have to keep track of time. If something went awry and they needed to be picked up earlier or later from the JCC or the YMCA or a birthday party, they would be forced to ask the adult who was there to help them contact their parents. Keeping track of time and speaking to adults they don't know are both very useful skills. These are not revolutionary ideas, folks, and they are not always feasible. But before we conclude that the only answer to any logistical challenge is to give our kids a phone, before we determine that the only way to keep our children quiet or entertained or distracted is to turn on a screen, we should try imagining some other possibilities. The experts who are trying to reassure us about technology are not fooling anyone. We know, deep down, that screens are affecting our children in adverse ways. It is time to stop sugarcoating the truth. The more we know, the better equipped we can be to push back against the pressures coming at us from all directions. Thank you very much.
Quite all right. Wow. Thank you, Naomi. That was a tour de force, and it was so comprehensive that I don't think there will be any questions at this point. I mean, you've just made your case. But we'll check and see if there are questions from the audience. And I want to start, take the moderator's privilege, and just kind of probe on a couple topics. The overwhelming thing I noticed as you were speaking is how much of this is not about the kids, but about us who, that is us who are parents or who are the ones really making the decisions and setting the agenda. And I wonder if you could talk a little more about that, because it just seems to me so much of this is actually not about solving problems that kids have, certainly not about solving problems that previous generations did not solve. They're actually about solving problems that we feel like we have. And, you know, starting from your very poignant story in the hospital waiting room to all the things we're trying to get done, to our own devices that are distracting us. So what do we have to do or become in order to be the kind of people who would be willing to do this rather painful work of reducing or even eliminating these screens?
I guess I'll just keep going here. So yes, I mean, this is a topic I really approached from the parents' perspective, because as you say, I mean, these decisions are in parents' hands. I think sometimes we forget about that, but it's true, largely. So I wrote a column right after the new year about sort of comparing the use of technology and trying to fix our relationship with technology to starting a new diet. And I think that there are a lot of useful comparisons there. the first thing, and I mean, I want to talk about some just very concrete things here. I mean, the first thing, as with any part of parenting, is the consistency. It is so easy to wear us down. And, you know, just like you are repeatedly offered chocolate cake or glasses of wine or something like that over and over and over again, and you're going to say, oh, I'll just make an exception this once, you'll make an exception tomorrow and the next day and the next day. And kids know this. So you're in the supermarket line today, and they're bored, and they want to play on your phone, and they say, Mom, can I have your phone? No, 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 no. But last week, you're like, ugh, can't believe you remembered that. You know, they're homesick from school, or, you know, or there's a snow day, or whatever it is, kids will remember the occasion that you gave in, and they will say, the next time that occasion happens, I'm going to ask because I know you gave in the last time. So I think the first thing to do if we are actually going to start over and rethink the relationship with technology is to put down new rules and actually be as consistent as possible for as long as possible with them, because they know our weaknesses, and that is, you know, that is the hardest part now. I think it's just the being constantly bombarded, because my parents never faced this. Once I left the house, there was no television. I mean, I can't turn it on for you. Like, maybe I'll make an exception tonight, later, 12 hours from now, whatever. But the question is, this thing is in your pocket, and someone is demanding that they get it. And you want to do other things. You want to finish your grocery shopping. You want to be on your device. And so you have to sort of say, no, this is not happening today. It's not happening tomorrow. It's not happening at the supermarket. It's not happening in the car. I mean,
sense of Dr. Seuss book.
Oh, yeah, that's exactly it. Yes. I will not give it to you in a box. I will not give it to you in a box. I do this all day long. No, this is true. And one of the other things I think is important with the comparison to the diet, though, is, you know, any you know, nutrition consultant will tell you, well, you can't feel deprived all the time. You have to somehow replace this thing that they want with something else. So, you know, you don't obviously want to just, if you're on the diet, go and replace it with food. But you want to replace it with other activities, other fun things that people want to do. And so you have to say to your kids, like, okay, it means that instead of just ignoring them in the supermarket line, you might actually, you know, have to engage them, have a conversation, start a game, you know, or maybe it means that you're taking a Rubik's Cube into the supermarket or something else. I mean, it has meant for our family that there is a whole lot of crap in my car to replace the iPads. I mean, there is coloring, there are Rubik's Cubes, I mean, it's ridiculous. And that's one of the things, actually, that I noticed very early on about the difference between letting kids play with technology and something else. Technology, you don't have to clean up. And that is a huge temptation. The difference between setting your kids down at an art table and saying, okay, I'm going to clean up the paint or the Play-Doh or whatever it is at the end of the day, and just saying, oh, here's the iPad. And now I've taken it away. And now I've given you the iPad. Now the vacuum cleaner has never come out. The broom has never come out. And to me, that is a huge temptation for parents.
Wow. One other word you used several times, and you were getting at it here in these last few sentences too, that I just thought was a very poignant word, is trade-offs. And I wonder if you could expand on, once we trade in the devices, that is, we get rid of these devices in the way you're pushing us to, what replaces them, and why is that really good? And what comes in, or can come in, once you've made room
right
in that way?
So one of the things I've kind of, you know, swept over here, which I shouldn't have, is obviously we're talking about kids at all different ages, and I wanted to make this topic as broad as possible for everyone who's here. But I think at some point you have to look at the different stages that we're talking about. So, you know, parents are starting to give their kids technology before the age of one. So the question is, you know, what do you give a one-year-old or a two-year-old instead of an iPad? And parents will say, well, look, you know, but that's actually keeping them occupied, and I can actually clean the kitchen, I can actually take a shower. Like, I mean, I sympathize. I never quite, the mothers who told me that they actually didn't take showers, like, I couldn't go there. But that was sort of like, look, you're going in your crib, you're going to stay there. If you want to scream for 15 minutes while I take a shower and get dressed, you could do that. But I think, you know, there is something to be said for the notion that you know, you do want a few minutes to yourself if you're at home with a young child. So, you know, I was looking at reading this, telling you about this Marie Wynne book, The Plug-In Drug, and she talks about this a lot. And she said, look, there's going to be some upfront investment that you have to do as a parent. You have to watch your child for a while. You have to figure out what activity is going to entertain them for a while. She said, you know, look, as I said, it might make a mess, but she said, look, maybe kids, you know, want to cut up magazines, they want to glue, they want to watercolor, they want to, you know, run around in circles, they want to, you know, whatever it is that they want to do, you know. So when my daughter was 18 months old, my husband and I are both journalists, we get a lot of newspapers, all she wanted to do was rip up newspapers. I mean, you could go a good 30 minutes ripping up newspapers. Now, again, huge mess, newsprint all over, needed a bath at the end of it, but there was no stopping her with the Sunday New York Times. There were these activities where, there are activities where at a certain age, kids will just keep going, and they can get into this. We don't give them much of an opportunity to do it, because as soon as we're like, oh, you've done this activity for 10 minutes, we have to switch to someone else, we have to go someplace else. You know, a lot of the time, we're interrupting them in the middle of what they're doing. So when they finally kind of get into something, we're like, oh, it's time to go to the play date, it's time to go to Mommy and Me, it's time to go to the supermarket. I think, you know, we often don't give kids enough of an opportunity in that way. When they're older, I have to say, you know, once you get past the age where kids can read, for me, there's not much of an excuse for not telling them to go read a book for half an hour. I mean, look, I know some kids enjoy reading more than others, but in our house, that is the expectation. My mother always told me, I don't want to hear you're bored. And I have told my kids, I don't want to hear you're bored. And I'm happy to buy them. I spend a ridiculous amount of money at Barnes & Noble. You could obviously go to your local public library, but the kids do seem to enjoy the fact that packages from Amazon keep coming and coming and coming. They think like but for me, like, that is money hugely well spent. Go read a book for half an hour. So now we're getting to an age where my youngest has not started reading yet, and she's actually like a little bit annoyed because my older two will go off and read, and she's like, well, who's here to entertain me? So now I actually have to sort of finagle it. I'm like, will you stop reading and go play with your sister for a little bit? But again, you know, this sort of gets back to also making sure that there are, you know, enough people around to entertain each other. I think it's much harder for, you know, for an only child, for instance.
Wow. Thank you. I know there are questions. I have a mic. I will bring it to you. If you raise your hand, we'll get through as many as we can in 15 or 20 minutes of conversation. So if there are not hands, I certainly have more.
Hey, thank you so much for coming. I just had a quick question. Earlier you were talking about us not wanting to let kids play outside by themselves because, and you know, you made the joke about helicopter parenting. And then later you talked about suggesting basically blanket supervision over online communication and texting and stuff like that. So I guess my question is, do we need more helicopter parenting, or do we need less of it, or somewhere in between, and what factors and arenas and stuff like that? Thank you.
So that's a great question. I think primarily, I don't think that the dangers to children are where the culture is having you believe the dangers to children are. So I think most of the people in this room live in a neighborhood where it is perfectly safe for their children to go outside and play. I could be wrong, I could be overgeneralizing, but I think we are far too concerned about people abducting our children and not concerned enough about what is out there online that is possibly getting to our children. And when I say, and I'm not talking about, you know, predators who are, that also seems to be the focus of our concern. When we are concerned about online material, we're concerned that there are old men out there trying to lure our 13-year-olds to the mall so they can abduct them. That is not happening in large numbers, by and large. And that, unfortunately, seems to be the focus. It is the material. There is so much out there online that I don't want my children seeing that is not appropriate for them yet. And you know, things that we do not let in through the front door are now coming in through the back door. And I talked to so many parents and experts about filters. I mean, this was at first this was the complete subject. I wanted to know what was the effective filter that was out there to make sure that I could control what my children were seeing if I gave them the iPad. I talked to parents, they're literally professionals. Like, you know, some people come childproof your home, you know, putting covers over outlets. There are people who will offer to come childproof your internet in some ways. You know, there are parents who told me they would, you know, but inevitably it didn't work. You know, their kids would turn on YouTube, they were watching some video of kids playing with Barbies, and the next thing you know, their kids were watching videos of people doing unmentionable things to Barbies, because that's the next thing YouTube suggests you watch. So for me as a parent, sorry, just gets the anxiety level, it's not just teens. But for me as a parent, I don't want that. And so I really have to say, yes, this is when I helicopter. I helicopter when my kids are being exposed to things that I think that adults generally should be exposed to. And I was joking, you know, earlier at dinner, I'm very sympathetic to the free-range parenting movement. In fact, the only way that I don't think, the only reason I don't, you know, want my children to just wander around all day is because I fear all the kids are just going to end up at the park watching somebody's phone. Like, you could bicycle for miles around my neighborhood and I wouldn't have a problem with that. But if you go next door and end up having unfiltered access to whatever it is that's out there, like, that's going to be more upsetting to me than whatever it is you're going to encounter on any street nearby. So I don't know if that
great was great answer. Right. Thank you. Yeah. I will come back this way.
Hello. Hi. You actually tied in perfectly to the question I wanted to ask. Okay. I have an 8 and 10-year-old too, and I'm very strict in my house. And when they say, oh, I want to play with my friend at their house, that means because their mom will let me play video games for 3 hours, and you will let me play for a half an hour, and then we have to come up with something else to do for 2.5 hours.
Yes.
So how do you suggest that parents navigate the relationship with other parents when other parents have wildly different rules and regulations? I talk with my kids before they go to somebody else's house. What are my guidelines for video games and for a computer? If you hear such and such, if you see such and such, you say, my mom says I'm not allowed to do that. Let's do something else. Like, that's right. The only thing I can think of, but right. I can't make them want to play at my house with no screens.
No, that's true. No, it is a real problem. And I will say the first part of the problem is that it's very hard to be a judgmental parent these days. You will not only, you know, get in trouble with other parents, you'll get in trouble with the school. Like, oh, you know, you can't go around saying so-and-so, you know, you don't approve of something that they do. That will be, you'll be called onto the carpet for that. I will say that I don't generally tell the kids, like, you must stick to my time limits, or, you know, we have no screen time during the week. So if they go to a friend's house, you know, during the week, which is pretty rare, I'm not going to say, like, you have to live by my rule in terms of the amount of time. But yes, I think we need to talk to them about content. And I have talked to other parents. I have had to. I mean, my daughter's best friend got an iPhone at the age of 7. It had unlimited internet access, and she rode the bus every day with the girl to and from school. So I found this out. I called up the mother, who I know well, and I said, and she's a Yale-trained pediatrician, and I said, I should not be telling stories. And I said, look, Allison, I said, I don't want to discuss your decision about the phone. I just want you to know I have told my daughter she is not allowed to touch your daughter's phone. And you should make that clear to your daughter. And this prompted like a half an hour long disquisition on why she had gotten her daughter the phone in the first place, which boiled down to, what if she's unhappy at a birthday party and she wants to come home? So I won't even go there. But I will say... But I will say, like, at a certain point, yes, you have to have the courage of convictions and sometimes talk to the other adult and say, when my kid comes over, I would appreciate it if you did not allow them to go on, go on YouTube or play on Facebook. I mean, and I've had to do this in all sorts of contexts. I mean, recently, one of my kids came home and they had done a video at school and the teacher had put up the video on YouTube. I emailed her and I said, look, for reasons of privacy and security, I said, I don't want this up there. I said, you can put it on a private channel if you want, but I do not want this publicly available. And I've become known, obviously, now I'm writing about the topic, but, I become known as the obnoxious mother who's going to, tell you this is a bad idea. I'm not going to tell you how to raise your children, but if my child is coming over to your house, I want to have some assurance that there's not going to be something wildly inappropriate going on. And look, you would say that's true offline as well as online. If you don't trust the parents to have a reasonable sense of what their children are doing, particularly at the, 10, 8, 7. I mean, your kids shouldn't be there regardless.
Yes.
Yeah, I kind of take a little bit of a different thought on that, and I'd like to hear your thoughts on this, because my thinking was, my kids are going to get exposed to this eventually. They're going to see the dark corners of the internet, or at least know they're there. So the idea of trying to protect them, to keep them from seeing all of this stuff and blocking it, I feel like is sort of not worth going too crazy on. Do you have any thoughts on, okay, when you inevitably run into this stuff, what then? Or how to prepare yourself, or how to prepare your children for the fact that they will inevitably run into this stuff, the bad stuff?
That's obviously a slippery slope argument. I mean, you could say, I'm going to expose my 7-year-old to this stuff because they're going to inevitably find it. I'm going to expose my 10-year-old to this stuff because they're inevitably find it. I'm going to expose my 4. I mean, there's obviously different ages at which they will, quote unquote, inevitably find it. Parents I've talked to say that they're now having conversations with kids, certainly by age 9, about pornography, if their kids are allowed online. That is not a conversation I want to have with my children right now. And so that's one of the reasons that I don't give them unfettered access to the internet. When I am ready to have a conversation with them about pornography, that's probably the point at which they will have more access to the internet. I mean, I think we're thinking about this in the reverse. If you don't feel comfortable talking to your 10-year-old boy about what's in some of these videos and when they should know that this is not something they should be watching and why people make it and why, I mean, I don't know about your kids, but my kids will ask, I have no idea how many questions if I start talking to them about the issue of pornography. I can't even imagine all of them. And so that will have to be a decision that I make, at some point a couple of years down the line where I say, look, I'm going to give you a little bit more freedom, but you should know what's out there. But right now, I think that's, The answer to your question is, I think, more of a personal question for parents about when they're ready to tackle these topics with their kids. It's not an internet access question.
Hi. I have a comment and a question. So my question first is, we have a 12-year-old that we gave a phone to for her birthday. We made a mistake. I want to take it away. So then I have my 11-year-old who's turning 12, and, we thought we were going to give her a phone because we thought that was the right age. We want to change our mind and make it 16 because we just see that there's so many things that have happened over the year, with the 12-year-old. And we have boundaries, but, for that little time that they get to go on it, it's just too much. It's just way too much for our household and our family time. So how do I take it away? Because now she has all these friends on the, that she socializes with, and she went from, a year ago playing with her sister, in the house, school, doing all this great stuff, and now she's like a robot. But why are we not talking about the issues of the radiation with the phone? Because if it does what they say it does to the brain with the heroin, and you see the heroin brain, and then you see the brain with the cell phone, what's going on with the soft tissue parts? And I'm not a doctor, and I don't know why this is just so much on my heart. I mean, is there enough radiation coming off that phone that it's really going to hurt our children?
I'll start with your last question. I have not seen any studies that have convinced me that the problem with the technology is the radiation. It seems to me largely inconclusive at this point. I think that there are definitely studies that look at difference in the brain structure from people who have, you know, engaged in serious amounts of screen time. There's a book that came out last year called Glow Kids that got into some of the most extreme cases. No, I mean, look, it got into the most extreme cases of people who were, truly addicted and could really, kids who could not function at all as a result of this. And it had affected the structure of their brains. It was a real addiction for them. But as far as, how you take it away, I mean, I think it's sort of like, it has to be like any privilege we give our kids. It didn't work out. I mean, it's not, from my own perspective, I think, there is an argument for dumb phones. I know people think this is ridiculous, but if you open any magazine that's geared toward old people and you see like the jitterbug or whatever it is, if the bottom line is that we need to have some way of communicating when it is I'm supposed to pick you up from the bar mitzvah or something like that, okay, fine, like we can work that out. If you need to have some way of texting with your friends, maybe we can do that. But I think the fact that parents immediately jump to the smartphone is really baffling to me in some ways. I mean, I've talked to doctors who say, pediatricians, the parents come to them and they say, well, I got my kid a smartphone because, my phone plan was running out and I need to get a new phone, so I just figured I'd give it to them. And I mean, that's, it sounds like you obviously went through, a process here where you decided 12 was the right age. And now, I think you're doing something that a lot of parents are not doing, which is that you're assessing now what are the effects of this. It will be very hard to take that away from them. And I think, what you're saying is probably a lesson to a lot of people in this room, which is that you have to be very intentional about when you decide to give it to them, because prying it from their hands is going to be quite an ordeal if you decide it's not working out. So I guess that would be my I don't have much advice about taking it away, but I think there's a valuable lesson in there.
To take the moderator's privilege and ask the last question too. What do you hope for your own kids in the next 10 years? So 10 years from now, you'll come back to the Agora Institute. Give us a sort of catch up on how it went. And they'll be 20, 18, and 14.
I feel old.
What do you envision for them? Not meant to be a gotcha question. It's really like, what's the trade-off that you actually hope they'll make in their own choices and in your family's choices?
So, one of the things I said in my talk was that I think that, often we say we are comparing parents and kids, and we say, look, parents have this problem too. But I think that those of us over a certain age are at a little bit of an advantage, because we have had the time to develop the tastes and the temperaments and the habits of life without the phones. Now, we may screw that up, and we may go back and, use our phones too much, and our lives may be too hectic, and we may be looking at the screens too often. But I think in the back of our minds, we all have this recollection of what life was like before the phone. We know what it was like to enjoy things without being distracted. We know what it was like to not always be on call from work. We know what it was like to sit there and enjoy reading a book or just going for a hike or something like that without having this thing. And our kids, what I hope for my kids is to give them as much time as possible without that. With the sense, give them the opportunity to experience, life before all of these pressures, to understand what it's like to enjoy nature, to be independent, to read deeply, to not constantly be interrupted. It may not sound like a big thing, but I think if we all look back on our own childhoods, it's really something that was very important to us and something that is going to be really hard to replicate for our kids. So the longer I can put off those things, because as you said, it's really hard to go back. Once you've developed this method of communicating with your friends, once you're on social media, I mean, I know adults who have gotten off of social media And it's hard. Not only is it hard for them, it's annoying for all the people around them because they thought they were on Facebook, but they're not, and they thought they were on Twitter, but they're not. And they, you know, they thought they could constantly reach them by cell phone, but they can't. So once you've crossed that line, I think it's really hard to go back. And my goal is to just give my kids as much time as possible without that, and the hope that they will become independent, well-adjusted adults. And really, who can hope for more than that?
Naomi, thank you so much. Thank Naomi again. This evening has been such a great example of what the Agora Institute does, and RJ Snell, who founded it, along with others in this room, is going to just share for a few moments with you as we move towards the conclusion.
Well, good evening, everyone. Thank you, Naomi, for that, and Andy for hosting us, and thank you to the folks here at Sprint and Lake for hosting us as well. So Amy and I have recently moved in neighborhoods, and one of my neighbors finally told me that we've become something of a scandal in the neighborhood. And both of these are really Amy's fault, not my own. But the first reason I've been told by my neighbor is once or twice a week, Amy runs a cottage school out of the house. There's about 10 moms and about 40 kids in our house all day. And one of the neighbors was asking me about this, and I told him with a kind of wink, well, they're all mine. But that's still Amy's fault, not mine. But the real scandal that I was told is that our children climb trees in the front yard. And that increasingly other neighborhood children are noticing that the Snell children climb trees in the front yard. Now, that's not only about technology, it actually tells you something about why the Agora Institute is founded. which is that the front yard matters enormously. It made perfect sense to Franklin when he was sketching out the plans for Philadelphia that the city had to be organized around squares or parks. Because every decent society is organized around the public square or the plaza. And that when a society reverts back to merely private interest, to the backyard, to the mere interest of the individual and perhaps their small group, you know that something is decadent and decayed in the society. So 6 years ago when we founded Agora, the idea was that the public interest, the common good, mattered enormously. And I'm not entirely sure that in the 6 years since, in the most recent election, that we've seen evidence that things are getting better on that. But we were committed to the notion that genuine virtue and what it meant to be a human being required the plaza, the public square, to be together, a phrase which I like, to be locked together in argument despite our differences and disagreements. And so for 6 years, we've had people of all faiths or many faiths and none together. We've had people on the left and the right. We've tried to bring together people in conversation who should be talking, even if it's to disagree, but who increasingly are not speaking to each other or even at each other anymore. It's the end of the republic. It's the end of a free people when we cannot disagree and when we cannot draw together despite our differences. We're also committed to the notion that people of faith have something to offer, and that while they may not have all of the answers and do not, by their presence of faith, have any right to claim power, that they can show a better way. That people of faith know that their lives are not entirely their own, and so while they needn't have power, they also needn't revert to quietism. It seems to me that there's been a failure of imagination of religious people in our own society, in our own time. That many of us imagine that if we don't have power, we revert to the backyard and remain there quietly alone. Thank you so much for joining us. We hope in 6 more years we will in fact still be talking, not merely tweeting at each other. Although if you've ever met Kimon Sargent in the back room, you know you can be distracted by humor and not just by smartphones. It's impossible to hear anything when he's telling jokes the entire time. On the other hand, it makes it worthwhile. Thank you so much for being here. We hope to see you again. Later on in April, we'll be having John Haldane, one of the great philosophers of our time, hosting an evening. And we also have dessert for you to share with us this evening. Thank you so much for joining us.